Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the Nootbaar Conference, Doing Justice and Avoiding Harm. It's good to have all of you here with us in years past when we've done this conference at times. The weather's been awful back east, which has been good in some ways because then people really appreciate the sunshine of Southern California, but occasionally that kept speakers from being able to fly here and join us. Thankfully this year we've got nice, at least decent weather across the country. I don't think the weather is going to preclude any of our speakers from being with us. My name is Bob Cochran. I'm the director of the Nootbaar Institute, one of the sponsoring organizations. I'd like to welcome you on behalf of it. It's the Herbert and Eleanor Nootbaar Institute on Law, Religion, and Ethics. Herbert and Eleanor Nootbaar were great friends, sponsor the our organization. Unfortunately, Eleanor died a couple of years ago. Herb Nootbaar turned 107 this year. We were quite pleased to celebrate his birthday with him. The Nootbaar Institute does academic programs like this. We do book projects, symposia. And in addition, we have a global justice program. We send students around the world to do justice-related work with organizations like International Justice Mission and with governments. So we do a variety of things. The other organization that's sponsoring the conference is the Diane and Guilford Glaser Institute for Jewish Studies here at Pepperdine. The associate director, Michael Helfand, was very much involved in planning this conference but was unable to be with us today. The institute as well, it's a Pepperdine-wide program, and it does classes and courses. It sends students to Israel for the summer to do internships, and students, both law students and undergraduate students, participate in those. I hear that we may be in for a little bit of rain. It reminded me of a story 2 years ago. Michael Scafferlanda and his wife Maria were coming to the conference. They've been here for a couple of years from the University of Oklahoma. This year, it's his spring break, and he's taking a group of students to Uganda. He was going to be with us, but can't be. They came out together a couple of years for the conference and very much enjoyed escaping from Oklahoma in the middle of the winter to sunny California. Then, as now, Southern California was going through a drought. We had not had rain at that point for, it seems like, a year or so, and so we were very much concerned. We still are with the water situation here. And Michael said that on the Sunday before coming to the conference, he was in church in his Catholic church there in Oklahoma, and that the priest said, we all need to pray that they'll have rain in Southern California. And Michael says, yes, but not yet. I'm going for vacation for a conference next week. Well, anyway, we may get a little bit of rain, but I think we're going to have a lot of sunshine as well. And we're very excited to have you here and look forward to having you enjoy both the conference and much of what Southern California has to offer. People have wondered about the speakers and the panels and how it was all chosen. We identified a handful of speakers and a theme. I'll talk about how we identified the theme a little bit later. And then we just sent out a call for proposals. Many people in this room responded to that and had ideas and wanted to address our theme. And then we structured people into panels. It worked out, I think, in a wonderful way. But in some ways, this is a self-generated conference. It was generated very much by the speakers who had topics that were related that they wanted to address. The theme itself grew out of a conversation around the dinner table at Jim Gash's house. Gary Haugen, who will speak to us later on in the morning, was there. And I had read Brian Fickert's book, When Helping Hurts. You'll hear him later today. And it very powerfully illustrates that attempts to do justice, attempts to help the poor, very often have downsides to them, and very often they do more harm than good. And it's a book that powerfully brings that point home. And of course, Gary Haugen with International Justice Mission, all about justice. And so the notion of doing something on both justice and the challenges that it might bring grew out of that conversation. And as you think about it, that challenge arises in your individual life, it arises for countries, it arises for NGOs, and we've got people here that will be addressing those challenges all along the way. It arises for justice, and everyone in the room has probably been approached by a panhandler and wondered, am I helping or hurting by contributing here? Many of us work for organizations, work for churches or synagogues, and we'll do projects. A common project is to go down to Mexico. We'll send our high school kids down there, and they'll build homes while unemployed people are sitting around watching. Are we doing a good thing, or are we undercutting the local economy? I was on the board of an NGO that did work in a developing country, and we wanted to treat our workers well. We wanted to give them a living wage. We wanted to for them to be safe and not have to go into dangerous areas on motorcycles. So we would send them in cabs or with hired cars. And then we learned that there was great tension between our NGO and local NGOs that were trying to do some of the same work. There was plenty of work to go around, and it was wonderful work serving others, but these local indigenous NGOs couldn't pay the sorts of wages we were able to pay. They couldn't provide the sort of assistance that we were able to provide to their workers. Their workers all wanted to work for us. We wanted to be able to give great service to our clients, so we wanted to hire the best people, and we'd hire people away from them. So you can just see the tensions that are there. There's no easy answer to questions, to problems like that. As you think about law, I mean, if you were creating a country that had no laws, what law would you first create if you were going to have one law? We might start with thou shalt not kill. We're going to prohibit murder. People would disagree about what sort of punishment should be given. But even with a law like that, you create a legal system, no matter how perfect the system is, there's a danger that people will be convicted who aren't actually guilty. Every law that's adopted, I think, has a downside. And over the next couple of days, we're going to be talking about doing justice and avoiding harm in all of these different areas. Our session, you may have looked at the schedule. We're going to be here in this room for the morning and for an early afternoon session. Then we'll be breaking into two different sessions for the afternoon as we go on. I'll be discussing where those will be located. But here at the beginning, we have two keynote speakers. I want to just quickly say that in this room, we probably have 40 people who should be keynote speakers. We've drawn from across the country a terrific bunch of folks, and I just want to apologize to you for you not being a keynote speaker, if you're not. I want to apologize everybody for us keeping the introduction short. Everybody in the room should have a program that gives some additional data about the people that would be speaking. If you go to the website, you'll see that that everybody on the program has a 3, 4, 5 page website. But we really want to reserve time for discussion and for presentations. We're keeping the presentations short so that we can interact with one another. And that's the way that we've structured the program. So apologies to all the speakers, but that's the way it is. that's the way we like to have these Nootbaar conferences. To introduce our morning speakers, we have Naomi Goodnow. Professor Goodnow is here on the law faculty. She's been very much involved in these conferences in past years. 2 years ago, she addressed the group on intercountry adoption and wound up co-editing a book that grew out of that conference for Cambridge Scholars Press. Naomi's been very much involved in our justice-related work over the years. A few years ago, she went to Kenya for us and worked with IJM training African prosecutors in advocacy skills, which is part of what she teaches here at Pepperdine. So to introduce our speakers, Professor Naomi Goodman.
Thank you, Bob. I appreciate it. Well, thank you all for coming here, and what a very important topic this is, and I'm just so excited about the conversations that we are going to be having over the next couple of days. And this topic is so at the heart of what I do, what I want to do, and so I've been working on, Bob had mentioned I taught prosecutors in Africa. Kind of got a prosecutorial bent, and so whenever I think of these global justice issues, a lot of the times I come out like a prosecutor. So if you think of dealing with these issues, you know, it's kind of, and I have a toddler, and so anyone who has little kids will understand this, it's like the stick approach or the carrot approach, right? Do you reward or do you punish? And so there are wonderful work that NGOs have done and people in this room have done in educating, bringing aid to people in developing countries and trying to do justice in that way. On my side, the stick side, I'm working on an article right now that considers possibly bringing charges of crimes against humanity against mid-level officials, government officials who are not enforcing laws, particular laws in their own countries. Actually, there's very well-written laws, and looking particularly at sexual assault laws, in countries like India, Belize, and Cambodia. But just to give you some statistics, this is 2013, so they might be slightly outdated, but New Delhi, which is a city of about 10 million people, 635 rapes were reported, and in 2013 that resulted in one prosecution. So, you know, we could list a number of statistics in different countries. But of course, the question becomes, if we go about this in a stick way, what kind of harm are we causing? And it could be a lot. So I'm excited to hear what all of these wonderful speakers have to say about these issues. And it's my pleasure to introduce Rabbi Dorf, who's sitting next to me. Rabbi Dorf is an American Jewish University's rector and Sol Ann Dorf Distinguished Service Professor in Philosophy. For more than 30 years, he has taught a course on Jewish law at UCLA School of Law. He was awarded the Journal of Law and Religion's Lifetime Achievement Award and holds 3 honorary doctoral degrees. Can you please welcome Rabbi?
My wife and I have 8 grandchildren for whom it's all carrots, no sticks. Justice, justice shall you pursue, rings through the ages as one of the Torah's major principles. The biblical prophets rail against the people for their failure to achieve justice and issue clarion calls to reform that have shaped the conscience of Western civilization for thousands of years. Justice, justice shall you pursue appears at the end of several verses in the Torah that demand the institution of courts located in all regions where the people dwell, prohibit bribes, and warn against prejudice in the judgments of these courts. By mixing procedural concerns like the placement of courts in convenient places with substantive issues like the prohibitions against bribes and prejudice, the Torah indicates its awareness that the two are inextricably intertwined, that procedure affects substance, and that substance demands certain procedural rules. No human being can always know whose cause is right. Only God is privy to all the actions and intentions of every person. Nevertheless, the Torah obligates us to establish courts to dispense justice as well as we can, and it specifies procedural rules to help us do that well. So, for example, at least 2 witnesses are required to establish a fact in court in order to forestall collusion. To accentuate its prohibition of false testimony, the Torah includes it in the Decalogue, announced amid thunder and lightning in Mount Sinai. Moreover, a 20% fine is levied against witnesses who knowingly lie in a civil case, and full retribution is required for those who testify falsely in a criminal case. A judge's acceptance of bribes is roundly condemned, for bribes blind the clear-sighted and upset the pleas of those who are the right, or who are in the right. Each person is to be judged for his or her own actions exclusively, a principle assumed without question in modern Western societies, but very much at odds with the practices of many societies in ancient, medieval, and even modern times, in which relatives were punished for the crimes of their family members. The Torah insists that neither rich nor poor may be favored. You shall not be partial in judgment, hear out low and high alike. Fear no man, for judgment is God's. The alien, too, is to be treated fairly. Decide justly between any man and a fellow Israelite or stranger. The rabbis of the Talmud in the Middle Ages added many more procedural rules to ensure impartial treatment. For example, one litigant may not be required to stand while the other is sitting. Both parties to the case must wear clothing of similar quality. Judges must understand the languages spoken by the people before them, and witnesses may not be related to each other or to the litigants. Through rules such as these, procedural justice is strengthened and made a reality. Substantive justice speaks not to the method by which a judicial decision is made, but to the character of the results of court procedures, and more broadly, of society's policies. In Plato's Republic, substantive justice amounted to a social harmony, which could be achieved only when everyone did what his or her station demanded. The biblical view of substantive justice is radically different, stressing the equality of all human beings and their right to equal protection of the law. Thus, the Torah demands that aliens, widows, and orphans not be oppressed either in court or in society generally, that they be cared for since they have no protectors. Indeed, the mistreatment of the defenseless and the failure to protect them in court was denounced by the prophets as a sign of the decadence of the Israelite society of their time. The poor were also to be treated honorably and justly and cared for, and the failure to do that was also part of the prophets' complaint against their society. It is not only the downtrodden, however, whose cause the Torah champions as part of its insistence on substantive justice. All members of society must be treated justly. The Torah, therefore, includes lengthy lists of civil and criminal legislation for a society as a whole, and the later rabbis developed this extensively, beginning with the Mishnah's order of Nasi King. By formulating rules of procedural and substantive justice, the Torah and its rabbinic heirs transform justice from a pious hope to a concrete reality. Although the Torah and later Jewish tradition went about as far as any society could go in translating its moral and spiritual commitments into legal terms, The rabbinic authorities recognize that justice never can be captured totally in law. As a medieval Jewish phrase puts it, one can be a scoundrel within the limits of the law, or interpreted somewhat differently, a scoundrel with the sanction of the Torah, naval bereshut haTorah. Consequently, while the Bible as a whole depicts the substance of the law as both life-giving and a source of goodness, in sharp contrast to the abominable acts of other nations, the Torah additionally requires the doing of what is right and good in the sight of the Lord. The rabbis of the Talmud take that and other verses in the Torah as the basis for declaring that people are obliged to go beyond the letter of the law. Indeed, they state that the Second Temple was destroyed because people during that time did not acknowledge or fulfill such moral duties. Thus, while the Torah and the rabbinic tradition helped to make justice a reality by giving it concrete expression in law, Jewish law itself recognizes that justice sometimes demands more than the law does, that moral duties go beyond the letter of the law. Moreover, those moral duties sometimes require reshaping the law so that in each new age it can continue to be the best approximation of justice. The Torah thus goes beyond defining justice in its procedural and substantive aspects. It insists that justice is a divine imperative. In Western legal systems, justice is an instrumental good, a commodity important for social peace and welfare. That motivation to achieve justice appears in Jewish texts as well. But Jewish sources add another important motive. God demands justice and makes the existence of the world depend upon it because God himself is just. In fact, God is the ultimate judge, who, quote, shows no favor and takes no bribe, but upholds the cause of the fatherless and the widow and befriends the stranger, providing him with food and clothing. That's Deuteronomy 10. As Moses proclaims in his parting poem in Deuteronomy 32, for the name of the Lord I proclaim, give glory to our God, the rock, his deeds are perfect, yea, all his ways are just, a faithful God never falls, true and upright is he. It is precisely because God is just that Abraham can call him to account for his plan to destroy Sodom, regardless of the innocent people in it, with the words that ring through the ages. Far be it from you to do such a thing, to bring death upon the innocent as well as the guilty, so that the innocent and guilty fare alike. Far be it from you, shall not the judge of all the earth deal justly? God's justice is also at the heart of Job's complaint. And God thunders in reply, would you impugn my justice? Would you condemn me that you may be right? God's justice may be inscrutable, but it is for the Bible undeniable, a core characteristic of the divine. God enforces his demands of justice. He hears the cry of those who suffer injustice and responds by punishing the perpetrators. Thus the Torah admonishes, you shall not abuse a needy and destitute laborer, whether a fellow countryman or a stranger in one of the communities of your land. You must pay him his wages on the same day, before the sun sets, for he is needy and urgently depends on it. Else he will cry to the Lord against you and you will incur guilt. It is not enough, however, to be just from fear of punishment or hope for reward. Justice is necessary for holiness. All Israelites are obligated to aspire to a life of holiness. You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy, says Leviticus. In the verses that follow that divine command in Leviticus 19, the Torah specifies that holiness requires providing for the poor and the stranger, eschewing theft and fraud, rendering fair and impartial decisions in court, treating the blind, the deaf, and the stranger fairly, and ensuring honest weights and measures, all components of a society that has both procedural and substantive justice. One other aspect of the biblical concept of justice derives from its theological foundations. God loves the people Israel for reasons having nothing to do with their numbers or their power, the usual marks of a nation's greatness. And he promises the patriarchs to continue that relationship through the generations. The Israelites, in turn, are to love God and always keep his charge, his laws, his rules, and his commandments. The commandments of the Torah are thus not legalistic formalisms, totally divorced from human compassion, moral values, and a spiritual relationship with God, as some Christian writings portray them. Quite the contrary, the practice of justice is an extension of love, as demonstrated by commandments calling on all Israelites to love your neighbor as yourself in Leviticus 19, to love the stranger, repeated 36 times in the Torah, and to love God. In fact, one of the primary expressions of God's love is precisely that he provides human beings with rules of justice. Very much like parents who love their children enough to take the time and energy to insist on proper behavior because they know it will ultimately be in the children's best interest, the stick, so the Lord commanded us to observe all these laws to revere the Lord our God for our lasting good and for our survival, as is now the case, Deuteronomy 6. Again, bear in mind that the Lord your God disciplines you just as a man disciplines his son. Therefore, keep the commandments of the Lord your God, walk in his ways, and revere him, Deuteronomy 8. The Torah itself, and the rabbis even more, appreciated the fact that justice, to become a reality in people's lives, could not be left as a general value to which one mouths allegiance, but had to be translated into concrete terms. By presenting specific cases, both the biblical and the rabbinic traditions made the demands of justice clear and binding. It was not enough to require a person who finds a lost object to return it, as you have it in Deuteronomy 22. What if not one, but several people claim it? How shall you determine the real owner? What happens if you cannot? What should you do, on the other hand, if nobody comes forward to claim the object? Must you keep it? If so, for how long? To what extent must you go to publicize that you have it? If it requires care, for example, if it isn't a cat, must you spend your own money to provide that care? To what extent? May you use the object in the interim? Returning a lost object is a relatively simple demand of justice, but as these questions demonstrate, even a straightforward requirement easily becomes complicated. And the rabbis, in fact, devoted an entire chapter of both the Mishnah and the Talmud to this issue. Without that discussion, the Torah's imperative to return a lost object would remain imprecise and unworkable, demanding, in some understandings, too much, and in others, too little, to make this aspect of justice part of the ongoing practice within Jewish communal life. Justice in the Bible, then, is made a concrete reality by spelling out at least most of its demands in specific laws. The Torah and the later rabbinic tradition insist, though, that we do the right and the good, even when the details of the law would permit us to do otherwise. The Jewish tradition thus recognizes both that the legal framework is indispensable in making justice a reality, and also that the demands of justice extend beyond the law, however extensively it is defined. The Torah and the later Jewish tradition also place the demand for justice in a theological context, thereby undergirding the authority of the demand for justice and giving it a rationale. We are to be just because God requires it of us, and because that is one important way in which we imitate God's ways. These legal, moral, and theological parameters of the biblical and rabbinic concepts of justice make it an ongoing living component of a life lived in loving covenant with God. That's it.
Gary, come on down. If you come on down, I'll introduce you. You can come sit over here. Thank you, Rabbi. I appreciate it. I'm also a procedural professor, and so when I hear things about justice and procedure, my heart just skips a beat. Well, I want to welcome Gary Hagen. He's the founder and president of the International Justice Mission. His work to protect the poor from violence has been featured by Foreign Affairs, the New York Times, the New Yorker, Forbes, U.S. News and World Report, The Guardian, and he has wonderful books. Some of them include Good News About Injustice and The Alokus Effect, Why the End of Poverty Requires the End of Violence. Gary, it's great to see you. Welcome.
Good to see you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, good morning, everyone, and Rabbi, nice to be with you.
Likewise.
And Professor, thank you. I'd like to thank Bob Cochran for the invitation, and congratulations on convening this tremendously marvelous time together. So grateful to be part of it. I'm grateful for Pepperdine Law School because it is, in a unique way, beginning to lead in very intentional ways to make sure that the legal profession actually serves the purpose of justice. Now that might seem like an obvious thing that the legal profession should do, but I think many of you might experience the bait and switch that happens when you go to law school, where in many respects, you associate the practice of law with this larger aspiration of justice, and then go off to our professional school, in many respects find that the legal profession is really attuned to the excruciatingly rigorous regulation of very complex rules of a highly affluent and complex society, so that it runs efficiently and well. But whether or not, and that's good that it runs efficiently and well, and we need rules by which that happens, and we need very complex ones for a complex, vast society. But whether or not it actually ends up serving the purposes and ends of justice can be quite lost. And then the profession becomes separated from the heroic, from the aspiring ideal. What I love about Pepperdine is the tremendous intentionality with which there is this desire to see that the profession actually serves that end. So I'm so grateful to be associated with it and to be here with you. The little title that I gave to my remarks is the subject of ending impunity. And that I believe this is the indispensable and most intimidating challenge facing the global poor. Not long ago, in the state of Oregon, there was a woman who was alone at home in her house on a dark Saturday night, and she started to hear a man tearing into her house. This was horrible for her because this man had actually put her in the hospital from an assault just a few weeks before, and she's home alone in her rural house that's quite isolated. And so in that midst of that terror, she does what we'd all do. She picks up the phone and she calls 911, but only to have this extremely awkward conversation with the 911 operator, who tries to explain that due to budget cuts in her county, there is no law enforcement available on the weekends. And this is a Saturday night. It's not Monday through Friday. So in this incredibly awkward exchange over time, it's discussed, well, could you maybe ask him to go away? No, that won't work. Could you maybe go out another way? No, he's blocking my only escape. And you can feel the pain of this 911 operator of trying to address a problem when there is no law enforcement. And finally, she just says, well, I'm sorry, maybe you can go to the sheriff's office on Monday. And I'm sorry, but we just don't have anybody to send for you. And of course, eventually that conversation ends. The man, in the absence of law enforcement, does break his way in, assaults her, strangles her, rapes her. Because this is what happens when there is no law enforcement in your area. When you can commit that kind of violent act with impunity, no one will stop you. And the reason I share the story, of course, is because it gives us, who are used to a average 10-minute response time to a 911 call to the police, a insight of what life is like for 2 billion of the world's poorest, who live in a place of zero access to law enforcement to protect them from violence. That's not an exaggeration. The UN not long ago came up with this quite extensive study that came to the following conclusion, quote, most of the world's poor live outside the protection of law. And for the 2 billion people who live off $2 or less a day, they live in a place where no one is going to come to enforce the most basic laws to protect them from violence. And what are the implications of that? What does that level of impunity look like? In Bolivia, currently, it means that statistically, if you sexually assault a child, you're at greater risk of slipping in the shower and dying than you are of ever being convicted for that crime. So whatever level of stress you have today that you're going to slip in the shower and die, that's the level of concern a perpetrator has that he might go to jail for having sexually assaulted a child. Likewise, in South Asia, if you enslave a poor person, statistically, you're at greater risk of being struck by lightning than you are of ever being convicted for that crime. So what we have for the poorest of the poor, because of the catastrophic disintegration and congestive collapse of public criminal justice systems, we have a zero functioning on behalf of the common poor of the most basic systems of law and order that would protect the poorest from violence. What this means is there's now an epidemic of everyday violence against the poor, and I say everyday violence because many times the violence that comes to our mind most acutely for the poor in the developing world is the catastrophic violence of conflict and of war, which does, in fact, of course, make it very difficult for millions of the world's poor to make their way out of poverty. But for billions of the world's poor, the greatest violence that they confront is everyday violence, and four specific categories of violence. The first is gender violence, domestic violence, sexual violence, such that the World Health Organization found that for women and girls between the ages of 14 and 44, gender violence accounts for more death and disability than malaria, car accidents, and war combined. So again, the challenge is the everyday vulnerability that women and girls experience from the most basic and crippling violence that is just around them every day. The second form of violence is forced labor. You will know that there's about 36 million people held illegally in slavery in the world today, more people in slavery than any other time in human history. And vastly, it is just the world's poorest of the poor who are taken into forced labor because it is against the law. But those laws are not actually enforced. And so we have vast numbers of the poor who are unable to get out of poverty, of course, because they're held intentionally in slavery. The third vast category of crime is police abuse and illegal detention. In the Corbett and Ficker book on looking how hurting helps, one of the things that they do is they reference a study done by the World Bank on the poorest of the poor, which was the largest study ever of actually asking tens of thousands of the world's poor, what does poverty mean for you? What does it look like? What does it feel like? And this was such a critical study because it looked at poverty from the perspective of those who actually are enduring it. And when the whole thing was published, the executive summary said that one of the most surprising findings of the study, you can imagine all the surprising things that they would find, but it said perhaps the most surprising study of the finding was the extent to which police and justice systems actually make poor people poorer, the way they make them less secure. And the fact is that for the poorest of the poor in the developing world, the way they experience policing is as a predatory gang within their neighborhood. In fact, it's now emerging that probably no one steals more money from the common poor than the local police in the developing world. Also, this results in millions of people held in abusive detention. About 10 million people held in pretrial detention. The vast majority are poor who will never have any kind of fair consideration of whether or not they deserve to be, there's any merit to their detention. Then you have another 30 million dependents that are being devastated by these breadwinners who are poor and being held illegally in detention. So that's the third category, is massive illegal detention and police abuse. And then the fourth is land theft. The poor, of course, depend upon their little plot of land for their little piece of shelter and for their garden to grow food. And when they become, when they are seen as vulnerable by more powerful families in the community, they will lose their land just by physical violence. So you have about 5 million poor people a year who are being thrown off their land. And the consequence of this, of course, is that it devastates the efforts of the world to try to end poverty. It devastates the poor's efforts to try to get out of poverty, because you can imagine you can give all manner of goods and services to the poor, but if you don't restrain the bullies from stealing it all away, at the end of the day, it just doesn't have the effect that you would want. This has been demonstrated tragically in regard to one of the great keys to poverty alleviation, which is the education of girls. They call it the girl effect, right? Because they know that perhaps the most powerful way to actually take communities out of severe poverty is to get the girls educated. But what they've also now found is that the most dangerous place for sexual violence now for girls is the schools. And that the primary reason, several studies are showing why girls are not going to school in the developing world, is because of violence. Violence in the home, violence on the way to school, and violence in school. So you can see the way in which, unless we are able to end the impunity with which people abuse those who are poor and bring to bear violence, it will be very difficult to be able to see them emerge out of poverty. In fact, the fight against global poverty is reaching this critical inflection point at the moment, where we seem to have reached a ceiling as to how many people can actually escape poverty. You'll hear a lot about the tremendous improvement in lowering the rates of extreme poverty, which is defined as living off $1.25 a day. And it's true that since I was in high school, it's gone from more than 50% of the world living off $1.25 a day to about 15% of the world living off $1.25 a day. So that's really great news. But if you bump that up to $2 a day, the same 2 billion people who were living off $2 a day when I was in high school are still living off $2 a day. And so there seems to be a ceiling that we're reaching, and substantially the data is showing now that unless you're able to actually protect those who are poor from violence, they will never be able to emerge from poverty. How did we get to this place? We've written this book called The Locust Effect, which tries to bring some of the explanation out, but there's four just quick things to note. One, it's just a legacy of broken criminal justice systems that were set up by colonial powers that were never meant to protect the poor from violence. They were meant to secure the ruling regime. And while the substantive law of those countries has changed a lot over the 50 years, the delivery system of law enforcement has not been transformed to a post-colonial purpose. Secondly, elites within these countries are benefiting from the absence of rule of law and a functioning criminal justice system, so they're disincentivized to actually change it and would be threatened by a functioning criminal justice system. Thirdly, there's been almost no meaningful investment in fixing the brokenness of criminal justice systems in the developing world over the last several decades of development assistance. We can't find 1% of development assistance going to address the brokenness of criminal justice systems. And the fourth reason, and this is perhaps one of the most surprising and overwhelming transformations in the developing world, that is just devastating, and that is the replacement of a public criminal justice system with a system of private security. So now there's been a wholesale withdrawal from the system that everybody knows doesn't work. But for those with money and power now, they have set up a private system to perform the services that were once relied upon through the public system. So now, for instance, in Africa, in sub-Saharan Africa, the largest employer on the continent is private security. In most of the developing world, the private police forces are many times larger than the public police force. India has the largest public police force because it's such a huge country, obviously, but the private police force is 4 times larger in the country. In a country like Guatemala, the private police force is 7 times larger than the public police force. So now you have a two-tier system of existence in the developing world. Those who are safe because they can purchase private security, then those who are too poor to purchase private security, and so they live in the lawless chaos of an abandoned and broken, dysfunctional public criminal justice systems. This is why I call this the most indispensable challenge facing the global poor at the moment. And that is because you won't be able to stop this violence without ending the impunity. And the impunity won't end until you have functioning criminal justice systems that actually bring to bear fair consequences for those who abuse the poor. And one of the most pernicious things that has occurred over the last several decades is this unhelpful imagining that you can reduce violence against the poor without ending impunity. And that this fantasy that you can end impunity without setting up functioning criminal justice systems. So we've had decades of workarounds to that solution. The idea that somehow if we can educate people enough about their rights, if we can somehow do enough alternate things to somehow address issues of violence, but we don't actually fix what's broken in the criminal justice system, that this will somehow stop the violence. It's never been demonstrated anywhere in the world that that actually works in the absence of a functioning criminal justice deterrent. So that's why I say it's indispensable. And this is what allows, I think, in this era, the legal profession to recover the heroic. Because there are places in the world right now where people live or die based upon whether or not the legal profession shows up to provide for them a system of most basic protection. And we have an era in which that struggle is engaged right now. And for the legal profession not to be involved in that struggle, to be contributing and to be part of the solution, is just to miss out on an opportunity for the heroic. And again, this is why I'm so grateful for the almost singular way in which Pepperdine is seeking to exercise leadership in this area. But I will also say this is why it's the most, well, we also would call it not only indispensable, but this is an intimidating challenge. And here's why, is that violence, first of all, is just scary and it fights back. Of all the problems that face the poor, dirty water doesn't fight you back, bad housing doesn't come and tear down your house, those who are, if you're trying to deal with hunger, you don't risk yourself becoming hungry. But when you take on the struggles of violence, you will immediately start to feel the intimidation of violence. But secondly, it's intimidating because this is the area where we most are afraid of doing harm. And this gets to the topic that we're addressing in these days, is it has felt enormously intimidating for those who care about the plight of the poor in the developing world. The idea to actually empower law enforcement to protect the poor sounds terribly scary, right? Because those are coercive systems. And during the Cold War, we did a lot of empowering of law enforcement in the developing world, and those systems were then turned against their own people and were used, again, just to secure political regimes. And so we actually made it illegal to assist law enforcement in the developing world through most of the 80s and the 90s. And many of those laws are still on the books. So we've actually taken the posture that the answer to bad law enforcement is no law enforcement, when the answer to bad law enforcement can only be good law enforcement, if you believe law enforcement's indispensable. But if you somehow believe it'll all get figured out some magical way without actually having good functioning criminal justice systems and law enforcement, then you can imagine there's another route. But once you say, no, where I live, I also depend every day on there being functioning criminal justice system, and I want the poor to have access to the same sorts of basic services that I rely upon, then you just realize we must actually engage this, but we must do it in a way that does not do harm. And I think that's the great hope, is that I think this generation is going to have the courage to step into doing that, because the last generation abdicated that. The wonderful hope is that, number one, history demonstrates that these criminal justice systems can be fixed. All of us live in communities that have flawed criminal justice systems, and there's certainly much that needs to be done to flawed criminal justice systems, and much that needs to be done to fix law enforcement. But if you were to live in LA County 150 years ago, believe me, you'd be living in a lawless chaos where the strong preyed upon the weak, and it would look much more, this county, like what the developing looks like world looks like for the poor than anything that you now currently experience as we have this nice day here in LA County. So history demonstrates it's possible to change this. The magic of deterrence means it can change much faster than possible, than you would have otherwise thought possible. And then perhaps the most encouraging thing in some ways of most recent years is we now can actually measure this. We've come up with some methodologies for measuring two things. One, the performance of criminal justice systems. So you can actually measure that it's getting better. You just don't have to do some training things and have 2 days at the Sheraton and then everybody goes home and you have no idea whether or not behavior actually changed. You can measure whether or not law enforcement is actually performing better, and you can measure whether or not violence is falling. This is difficult and needs a lot more work, but this is a game-changing development that we're seeing breakthroughs. And I think there's just a whole new generation now that is prepared to enter into this difficult realm, but also interested in trying to do it wisely in a way that doesn't hurt the poor, but actually seeks to provide them the protection that they deserve. So with that, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm going to interrupt just for a moment through the magic of technology. We're going to be able to share with you the story with which Gary started his presentation. It very powerfully illustrates what it's like to be in a situation where you don't have access to justice. I actually got this from Gary. I don't know whether you want to say anything to introduce this tape or just remind us of the story with which you began.
Sure. This is just the man who is coming through the house, and what you'll hear is the conversation here between the 911 operator and the woman who's asking for help.
I don't have anybody set out there. Obviously, if he comes inside the residence and assaults you, can you ask him to go away, or do you know if he's intoxicated or anything?
I'm only asking if I was still about 5 years. He's still getting 4 bucks from the door, ultimately.
Is there any way you can safely leave the residence?
Now we have an opportunity for questioning. I'm going to be carrying this mic around so I can capture your questions, and we'll let Naomi moderate the panel from here and call on folks.
Does anyone have any questions? Yeah, in the back.
we want to be able to get it on the table.
Hello, thank you all for coming and speaking. This has been a really great panel. And my question is for Gary, just regarding the final statistics that you said, that our government doesn't really allow or at this point believe in putting money or resources towards other public justice systems. Other than, obviously what your organization is doing and the incredible changes that you've seen, are there any other ways or other companies or non-governmental organizations that are able to address this where our government isn't?
Well, just to note that government policy on this for the U.S. government is changing, and it needs to change more. What's interesting is that we've actually made allowances for tremendous investment in law enforcement in the developing world to address crime that was washing up on our own shores. So we took on the risks of doing that in terms of engaging in countries in regard to counter-narcotics and counter-terrorism and somewhat into addressing arms smuggling, because those were urgent problems affecting us. And so we demonstrated, oh, you actually can do things to improve law enforcement. In fact, we're going to invest a lot into doing that. The problem is the absence of a political will to address the crimes that are just affecting the poor within those own communities. But I believe that there's a change of attitude emerging in that, and that's what needs to change. I think there needs to be a broad-based change of conversation in the way the development community addresses poverty by making sure that they're not only acknowledging violence as part of the problem, but prioritizing as indispensable fixing the brokenness of criminal justice systems. And this will require a whole new level of expertise, because that vast industry of development, economics, development assistance, has almost no experience with trying to deal with law enforcement systems or public justice systems. And what it is that you know about, what it is that you're learning about, will be of massive importance for the larger agenda of development assistance in the developing world. But we need to bring these two intellectual disciplines together.
I question the agenda at some level in the following sense. I wonder if reforming a criminal justice system in what are fundamentally unjust governments is a hopeless task, and that as we prioritize the problems of the world, building a successful and effective police force in a dictatorship strikes me as an unwise idea, and also an impossible task. So it's both hopeless and worthless. And so I question whether what we really ought to acknowledge is, first and foremost, we need to build democracy. And that after we have democratic systems of government, then we can talk about second-tier issues like a police force or a criminal justice system.
It's a fair question, because these things do go very much together. But if you take an example like India, for example, a reasonably robust democracy, otherwise regarded as functioning, carrying out very fair elections, participation of the community in those elections, it's a democracy. Most of the countries that IJM is working in, most of the countries where the 2 billion poor are living in, operate in a reasonably functioning democratic situation. So it's not entirely the case that it's hopeless, because these are dictatorial regimes in which you would have no opportunity to bring change. But what's also true is that that law enforcement system does have to be responsive to the community. So in that point, that's correct. What we found is actually possible in the Philippines, for instance, where we've seen our greatest success. Again, well-run democracy in most respects, but the difference between the advancement of the democratic system in that country and its functionality and the backwardness of the criminal justice system, huge catch-up that needs to take place and possible. So in your mind, you might just think, not North Korea, not Saudi Arabia, not the failed state of Somalia. You might think of the Philippines, of India, of Indonesia, of Malaysia, of Kenya, of countries that you would otherwise see as reasonably stable, developing democracies, but which the disparity between their advancement in certain categories of their political system and their law enforcement system is vastly different, and where investments could actually make a disproportionately amazing outcome.
Since I paid for this mic, I'm going to ask this is a question for Rabbi Dorf. So you cited the Torah, which is of course part of the scripture that Christians and Jews share. It's equal, it's the
requirement of equal treatment for the alien. And of course, that's a theme that you see running through the law, wisdom literature, and the prophets over and over, almost a mantra, how you treat the widow, the orphan, the alien, is the way that a country, or at least that Israel, was to be judged. And I'm wondering whether there's a lesson there for us in the current climate within this country.
Yeah, I mean, is this on? Yeah, I guess it is. I think one of the really groundbreaking things that you get in our scriptures is this notion that we're all equal before God, and that therefore justice has to be served along those lines. Equal meaning not only in terms of your particular ethnic identity, Israelite or non-Israelite in the case of the Bible, but also in terms of poor, rich, whatever you do for a living, whatever color skin you have, all of those kinds of things, right? That's radically different from systems of justice in the ancient world, and frankly from systems of justice in the modern world in a lot of places, where there is either de jure or de facto discrimination against certain elements of the society. My father had a friend who was a municipal court judge in Milwaukee, where I grew up. And when I started getting interested in these issues of law, he suggested that I come and sit in on a municipal court on a Monday morning, where you get all of the people over the weekend that we're going to first see the judge. And I must say, it was eye-opening. I mean, I saw people in my own home community from different parts of life that I had never seen before, right? Not because the law discriminated against them, but because, in fact, I mean, there was one fellow there that literally had a fifth grade education from Georgia and could not speak articulately about anything. There were, on the other hand, people in very good clothing and very articulate, and they were all races, and it was, I mean, you've got a real sense of the disparate parts of our society when you were on a Monday, the drunks over the weekend, as well as people with the monetary problems and all of that kind of thing, right? And I think one of the real glories of the biblical tradition that we've inherited is that it does it gives us at least the ideal of treating everybody equally, and not only the ideal, but the imperative to do so. I think in America, one of the reasons why I'm proud to be an American is because this is the greatest experiment in cultural and religious pluralism that has ever existed on the face of the earth, right? I mean, there was an article in the Los Angeles Times a couple of years ago that among the students of Hollywood High School, there were 70 different native languages, right? We are the new Ellis Island in many ways, right? And the fact that we're able to live in reasonable cooperation and peace and mutual benefit is amazing. Just look what's going on in a lot of other countries where you have including very good democracies like France and England, in terms of their issues with the Muslim population, especially France, right? And I think it's not that we're perfect. I mean, we certainly have had a lot of bumps along the way, slavery among them, and anti-Semitism among them, and a lot of issues in regard to the place of women. And I mean, we're not a perfect society by a long shot. But the fact that this is a society that really, from the very beginning, was based on biblical principles, I think has impelled us to at least strive toward that ideal. And I think that that's really important.
I have a question also about the I have in my notes that you mentioned that God's love provides human beings with rules of justice. Is there anything in the Torah or Bible that you can recall that discusses what happens to people who are wrongfully convicted and maybe wrongfully executed based on a crime they didn't do?
The straight answer to your question is no, okay? not in the Bible, per se. What you do get in rabbinic literature is an entire tractate of the Talmud about this. It's called Horayot, in which the question arises as to what happens when you're a litigant and you know that that the court got it wrong, right? And so it's an entire tractate of the Talmud talking about wrong judgments by court. And so it was clear that, to the Talmud at least, that that human beings, including people who are judges, don't get it all right. And all of these procedural rules were an attempt to try to make sure that that didn't happen. But there are no guarantees in life for this except death and taxes, right? But there was clearly, and there was an appeals process by the time you get to rabbinic legislation. Not really in biblical legislation, at least as far as I can tell.
Reverend Dorf, I was wondering if you've had any practical recommendations and suggestions on bridging the gap between standards of justice you're speaking about in biblical texts and applying them to our current reality in the justice system, as well as how can we raise moral and ethical values within the judicial system.
Okay, two different things. Part of the way, because we have an operating legal system that is really, really thoughtful, it's not perfect, but it's thoughtful, there are ways within the American legal system to self-correct. Part of the ways in which it self-corrects is through an appeals process. Part of the ways in which it self-corrects is through legislatures who change the laws when things are not right. Or a judicial system. I grew up in during the time of the Earl Warren Court, right, which was making major changes in American law especially about civil rights issues. I graduated from college in 1965. I'm 72. You don't have to guess. I was very much part of the civil rights era, and that was I went to college at Columbia in New York, and Thursday afternoons I was teaching in a Harlem junior high school. Seventh graders were reading at a second grade reading level, and I thought I was going to change the world on Thursday afternoons until the following week they had forgotten all the stuff I had taught them the first week, right? You get a certain amount of humility there. My last year I was teaching in another junior high school in Harlem. Ninth graders, who if anybody was going to go to college, these were the kids, at least that's what the teachers thought. And so I was doing enrichment work with them, and once during the middle of the year, the boys had a separate program, and so I had the girls by themselves, and they said, what do we need this for? We're gonna get pregnant in another year or two. Ninth graders, right? You could have wiped this white boy off the floor, right? Because it's just wasn't my world. And what I said to them was that it's not inevitable. I explained what the word meant. It's not inevitable that they would get pregnant, and they had something to do with that. But I think it's, as maybe even quixotic as those attempts were to try to get to some sense of equality in life, I think that's what all of us as concerned citizens really need to do. Part of it is through the legal system, through self-correcting mechanisms in which we get more equality and more morality in our society, both in the legal side and in the non-legal side. And then part of it is also through, concerned citizens working on the ground to try to make things better in life. I mean, I'm a past president of Jewish Family Service. Among the 60 such and some programs that we run in social services, are a whole series of programs to try to help the poor. We run homeless shelters. We run shelters for battered women and children, for example. Right? We run soup kitchens. Right, for anybody who happens to come, and we have a social worker at those soup kitchens to try to help them figure out how they can get a job or how they can get the skills to get a job. Right, I mean, those are the kinds of things, both legal and non-legal, social service kinds of things, governmental things, but also non-governmental things that I think are necessary in order to try to make at least our society better. It won't work necessarily in countries that have a collapsed government. I mean, I think you're right about that. But at least in our society, I think we've we do have a stable government, and I think we, and as a result of the platform for doing all these things, but it's not going to happen by accident. It's got to happen by a lot of commitment by concerned citizens to do these things yourself. One of my favorite, actually my favorite rabbinic saying is Rabbi Tarfon. Yours is not to finish the task, but neither are you free to desist from it.
Like the Torah's requirement of equal treatment, I'm calling some of the people on this side.
Ms. Rock, I just want to thank you for being here, and just know that your work has been an inspiration for a lot of us being here at Pepperdine, a lot of us being in the practice of law. So your work is not fruitless in that way. I just want to thank you for that. But my question is about appropriations. It seems that maybe these governments aren't spending money on the right things, perhaps. And I'm wondering if maybe we should just be spending time in their congressional bodies and getting them to appropriate correctly. I'm wondering if that's a problem, if you research that at all.
Yeah, it's a huge problem. In fact, many of us would many times think, well, these are very poor countries, so they don't have the resources to actually operate functional criminal justice systems. That's just not true. Most of the poor are now living in middle-income countries, not the lowest-income countries. So India would be a great example. Huge economy, tremendous economic growth, tremendous wealth. They could completely find the resources to have a functioning criminal justice system, but there's not the political will to do so. Part of that is because those with money and power have set up a solution with private security so they don't need it. And so, but the robustness of that private system and how expensive that is shows that society actually has the money. Because if you actually transferred those resources or even a portion of them to a public system, you could operate it quite well. It's a problem of political will in the society. And so I do think useful efforts that we've seen happen is assistance in catalyzing a coalition of forces in those communities to demand appropriate allocation of resources to build functioning criminal justice systems. That doesn't work very powerfully as long as the only people asking for that are the most marginalized political, politically marginalized sectors of the society. But when the middle class starts to engage that, and people of influence within the country, and outsiders can sometimes help strengthen those internal champions, that is a hugely value-added effort.
And we'll take one more question for our break. Professor Amy Altman will appear later in the conference.
Thank you. I'm interested, this might be for both of you. I'm interested in this move from, I think many of us, there are lots of us in this room who are very interested in working with scriptural understandings of law and kind of the aspirational dimension. And Rabbi Dorfman, as you put it beautifully, the practice of justice as an extension of love. I'm especially curious about what happens when we make the move to systems of secular and positive law, and the kind of damage and the harm that occurs in that process of making that leap because of the ways in which the secular law cannot read into the human heart. And so if, I don't know, maybe each of you, if you have a sense of what is the harm that occurs precisely because of the limits of the positive law and the insight that the positive law may not have into the human heart that other aspirational systems might have.
Well, I probably shouldn't get political here, but I mean, I think that's exactly Justice Breyer's book as opposed to Justice Scalia's book. I mean, I think it is a living constitution. That's my own philosophy of law. I've written a book, my own philosophy of Jewish law, but I think Jewish law also needs to be a living constitution, as it were, and that the way in which the law becomes moral. I think that positive law is an attempt to is a current fix on an attempt to try to make the law moral. But that as society changes and as our understandings of things change, that we have to be prepared to say that that was the fix then, and that we need to alter that fix now. That doesn't mean that the fix is bad. It just means that it was good for its time, or maybe it was okay for its time, maybe it was terrible for its time, but it was what people created at the time. And that we have to be, the law also, for me at least, the law always has to be open to moral critique.
I just remember what Martin Luther King Jr. said about the law. He said, the law will make you love me, but it will stop you from lynching me. And that matters to me, he says. So sometimes we're looking at what is the baseline that we're dealing with. And for the communities that we're engaged with, if the law could just keep them from raping, murdering, imprisoning, enslaving, that would be huge. And to not allow the paralysis around the difficulty of the eventual nuance of these matters to stop us from getting after what are very basic tasks right now.
But with that, why don't we give a hand to our moderator?